from the Oklahoman Newsroom, and it's time for Thunder Thursday, our weekly look at all things Thunder, and lots of NBA going on right now. I'm Jenni Carlson here in studio with our Thunder coverage team, Eric Horn, Maddie Lee. Guys, Thunder kind of quiet right now, but lots going on with the playoffs, and of course, the draft lottery happening Tuesday night. Zion Williamson, all the talk, all the rage. I kind of felt bad for those other guys who were there.
Get any mention.
No. And they're good basketball players.
They're going to get a lot of money.
So they'll be fine.
Don't feel too bad.
They'll be okay.
Okay, well, let's talk about Zion to New Orleans because New Orleans gets the top pick. They've obviously been in the news a lot recently for Anthony Davis. Would they keep him? Would they trade him? Eric, is Zion Williamson going to start the season on the same team as Anthony Davis?
No. Anthony Davis is going to be elsewhere. I think that it's a thing that might not happen in the next week or before free agency. It might be something that lingers on until the end of the season, like we saw with Kyrie Irving when he was traded to the Celtics a couple of years ago. But I don't think that Anthony Davis can come back. It'd be cool to pair those two guys together because it seems like their talents complement each other. But I think it's a situation where New Orleans is going to start fresh. They've got a new lifeline with Zion Williamson that they desperately needed. And this provides them with more leverage to go and seek out a trade for Anthony Davis because they have that star power. They have that guy they can lean on going forward. I just think that it's going to be a weird situation if Anthony Davis comes back after the trade demands and the way that he was being pulled from games, sitting out of games. I think it's time for them to move on from him and get what they can so they can rebuild around Zion and start fresh.
Even though, I think Anthony Davis will be elsewhere, is there an argument to be made that, hey, this guy was saying, I don't have the talent around me to contend. Now he's got a guy that some people, Maddie, are saying is the next LeBron. Is there reason to maybe think he's somewhere on a beach? I don't know what they do in the offseason when you're an NBA superstar. They're sitting around thinking, maybe this could work.
I think if there was going to be a chance, this is it. Alvin Gentry himself, I believe, said, it's got to make him pause. Like Eric said, a little bit of bad blood there at this point. Post-trade deadline has been super weird, so I wouldn't say it was likely, but I would say that the chances have gotten slightly better.
Yeah, and I think Alvin Gentry, he had a great reaction to this news that he's getting the number one pick, and... And the truth is, and please don't use the expletives that they had to beep out on him.
Heck yes. Heck yes.
But he handled the whole thing with Anthony about as well as could be expected. And he's got Jrue Holiday. If they do pull a trigger on a trade for Anthony Davis, Eric, they're going to have pieces. That's going to be another pretty darn good team in the West.
Yeah, look, they weren't a bad team when Anthony Davis played last year. Now, you don't expect Zion Williamson to step in and be an Anthony Davis,
right?
But they have something to build off of. And, even trading Anthony Davis could signal, the trade of Jrue Holiday because they might want to align some of the players in terms of age with Zion Williamson going forward so those guys can all develop together. But there's no team in the league that arguably needed this guy more than the New Orleans Pelicans, considering their situation. You can argue for Cleveland, but look, Cleveland was blessed with however many years of LeBron James. We shouldn't pity Cleveland in any way, shape, or form, and they got a championship out of it. Basketball could literally die in New Orleans if Anthony Davis or Zion Williamson isn't there in the next 4 to 5 years. So this was a big coup for them. It was a big time move for an acquisition or. Acquiring the pick and the opportunity to draft him was big for Alvin Gentry's career because this is a guy who's been much maligned and being able to get the most out of Anthony Davis. Big for David Griffin getting there in his first year and having the opportunity to pick Zion number one. But look, it's a situation where they have second life. They have second life as a franchise. And that's big for not just New Orleans, but it's big for the NBA too, because they don't want to see franchises die in cities. They never want that. With expansion, they don't want these teams moving around a bunch. They don't want basketball dying in a city where, there has been some interest, and they have had a decent team. This is a team that beat the Thunder 2 out of 3 times last year with guys like Julius Randle and Jrue Holiday and Anthony Davis. So they're not as far off as you think. They just need that one star guy to stick around and play, and Anthony Davis isn't that guy.
Eric said there's maybe no team that needed Zion Williamson more than the Pelicans. But I heard some people saying, aw, got to feel bad for the Knicks. I can tell you, I did not feel any remorse for the Knicks or the Lakers or any other big market team that didn't get Zion Williamson in that number one pick.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, small market is a completely different animal. And Eric just alluded to this. One of the biggest parts of getting Zion for the Pelicans is ticket sales, because they were struggling this year. I mean, when we were there, granted, picked up a little bit, but the game that I was there is pretty empty, at least to start the game. And so, and that's even when you have, you know, guys like Russell Westbrook who tend to fill arenas. So huge on the ticket sales front to try to keep this franchise alive and in New Orleans. And then also, we were all before this went down, because they did not have a very, very good odds of getting the number one draft pick. That was talked about as a trading piece for whoever got the number one pick, that they were going to try to use that to leverage to get Anthony Davis. And so now that they already have that number one pick, teams are going to have to get a little more creative to be able to actually vie for a player like AD.
And by the way, if anybody wants to say that the draft lottery is rigged, let's talk about 6% small market chance team that gets
Memphis getting number two.
Memphis getting number two. Yeah, exactly. So as Maddie said, everything now falls in New Orleans' favor, and it's going to be interesting to see what kind of deal has to be struck for them to move Anthony Davis. Eric, they demanded a lot midseason last year. What does that look like now?
I'm not entirely sure, but what I do think is it's something where they might be willing to take less because they have Zion in hand. It was a situation where they were asking for essentially the Lakers' entire team, or that was at least what the rumors were, or what the Lakers were offering. There's also out there that they never intended in doing the deal with the Lakers. They were basically just stringing them out because they felt disrespected by the whole notion of the Lakers basically trying to get their guy midseason and their guy demanding a trade to the Lakers in midseason. You know, the Celtics are still going to be in play, and some of the Celtics prospects are frankly they might be a little down on some of those guys, and their stock might have dropped, so they might even be able to squeeze more out of the Celtics than they were previously. Mm-hmm. You might see a team even pop up that's going for the big Toronto move. The big, you know, we have a good team. We want to have a great team. Yeah. I know Portland's going through a series right now where, you know, they've gotten a lot out of Damian Lillard and CJ McCollum throughout this run. People are going to say it's crazy to break up a team like Portland when you have two shooters that are that great. But what if Portland wants to make that upside play that Toronto did in terms of getting Kawhi in there and convincing him to stay in a market that you would otherwise not be able to get a shot at a free agent? Portland has struggled getting free agents to come there. So what if they make a move where they send one of those two, Damian Lillard or CJ McCollum, it would probably be CJ McCollum, to New Orleans so that they can get a chance at convincing Anthony Davis to stick around. I think there are going to be a lot more teams now in the summer, and this was part of the plan. You know, New Orleans would have more teams in the mix to talk about these trades once the summer hits, because you've got draft pick possibilities that can be moved. You know exactly where those draft picks are going to fall now that the lottery's been done. And teams are going to have more time to look at their assets and say, look, okay, this is what we can offer you. This is what we can offer you. They're going to be on the phone with every team in the league. I would expect the Thunder to be on the phone with them. It's not to say that the deal is going to get done, but you know, everybody's going to inquire about Anthony Davis, and this time in the summer is more viable time to make that move for him than it would have been in the midseason.
So if the Thunder will be one of those teams, everybody, Maddie, that's on the phone with the Pelicans, let's say that doesn't happen. How does this all – what are some impacts on the Thunder potentially? Is it about another Western Conference team potentially – getting good again in the Pelicans? I mean, what are some of those ramifications in your mind as this all starts to trickle down?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it has to do with East versus West. So, I mean, if you end up having the small likelihood that AD stays and suddenly you have the Pelicans emerging, or even if he doesn't and they are able to bring in all these assets, I think still they're not going to go from where they were this year to being a real Western Conference championship contender, but they're going to be creeping up. Then say AD does go to the East. Suddenly you have a little more of a balancing act. The East is already, we've seen this, especially during the playoffs, really good in those top three, four teams. And so starting to get talent moving over there. KD's decision this summer is going to have huge ramifications. So it's all really up in the air, and just a lot of really top talents balancing the
the whole league in very unpredictable ways at this point.
Yeah, and if he goes to the East, that's one thing for the East. But what if Anthony Davis ends up in the West still? What if he, you know, ends up with the Lakers or a Clippers, or, as you mentioned, Kevin Durant's decision? I mean, that could outweigh a lot. But this is, I mean, I know both conferences have gotten better in the last year or so, but it seems like the West is just continuing to sort of, and again, Memphis with the second pick, the Lakers up there. I mean, there's going to be some good young talent joining some of these teams too, Eric.
Yeah, and, you know, Zion's one of them.
Yeah.
New Orleans, as crazy as it is, New Orleans is an Eastern, I mean, a Western Conference team. So you're going to have Zion Williamson with Ja Morant presumably getting drafted by Memphis at number two overall. That can mean Mike Conley moves on to a Western Conference team. And Mike Conley's a veteran guy who's been around for years who would make a lot of teams in the West better. So, it's going to be a very interesting summer. It's never uninteresting in the NBA in terms of the movement. We don't know what's going to happen with Kyrie Irving. He could be going West. Kevin Durant could stay in the West. So there's a lot to still be played out. It's going to be interesting on draft night. I'm going to see where draft picks move. It's going to be interesting when free agency opens. Now a day earlier.
Yeah.
June 30th.
I know. 5 or 6 p.m.? Is that the set time?
Yeah, it's 6 p.m. Eastern.
So we don't actually have to, like, stay up into the middle of the night to figure out all this stuff, huh? Is that the bottom line?
We'll still be staying up.
Obviously a lot, and it'll be interesting to see how New Orleans plays all this considering the timing. Do they try to do something with Anthony Davis before the draft? Do they try to wait until the free agency kicks in? It's going to be fascinating to see what they do in that regard. Talking about movement, there's still some talk out there amongst folks that think one piece that could move from Oklahoma City is Billy Donovan. He has been rumored to be a favorite for big-time college coaching jobs. When you see John Beilein leave Michigan, now Billy Donovan supposedly in the mix, and if maybe a coach gets pulled from another top program to go to Michigan, could he be in line for that job? What's the chance that Billy Donovan is not the coach when the preseason camp gets underway?
Slim. Yeah. We see this legitimately every single time because he had huge success as a college coach, and he is a good coach and has proven that at the college level. And so every single time one of these top tier, even just like pretty good Division I programs opens up a coaching job, he's going to be at the top of the wish list or the rumor mill or whatever. And so don't read too much into it.
But everything I've heard, he's not going anywhere. It would be foolish of him to leave a good NBA job with a year on his contract to take a college job when he can have any college job he wants, essentially, whenever he decides to make that move. And frankly, Billy's made it clear to us over the past years that he's been in Oklahoma City that the recruiting, kind of the muckiness of the college game, that's something that kind of wore on him and that he kind of got tired of in his last days of college. And he was a guy who kept it clean. There were never any recruiting violations or anything when he was at Marshall or Florida. He ran a clean ship for a better part of 20 years. You've seen a guy like John Beilein, who went from Michigan to Cleveland to coach the Cleveland Cavaliers from going from the University of Michigan. He was a guy who talked about how, you know, he didn't like some of the ways that the college game was going in terms of all the recruiting and all the violations. We've seen some major recruiting scandals in the past year and a half in college basketball. So these guys that have the college credentials, you know, they really find it difficult in today's college game to really feel good about running a good program, there's a difficulty in running a good program, because John Beilein did it at West Virginia, he did it at Michigan, Billy Donovan did it at two stops. It's getting harder and harder to do that. It's getting harder to repel these guys who are always talking to these athletes and their families. So Billy Donovan would probably not be smart to leave a guaranteed year of NBA money at the chance of running even an elite program when he doesn't have to do that. Typically, guys who get fired from NBA jobs who came from college, they don't leave on their own volition. They get fired, then they go back to college. So I don't think Billy Donovan is leaving, and I don't think the Thunder's going to fire him this offseason. Fans probably don't like to hear that, but that's the reality of the situation.
Yeah, and if he didn't like the muckiness before, it's only gotten muckier. More mucky?
More mucky?
I don't know what the proper phraseology is, but it's a mess. And so that's an interesting point. All right, guys, before we get out of here, let's talk playoffs. And obviously, no Thunder involved, but some past Thunders still playing. Everybody from Enes Kanter, Ilyasova with the Bucks, Sean Livingston for old-time Thunder fans who remember him and his Thunder days. Several guys out there, Serge Ibaka obviously with the Raptors, but we've seen a game at this point of both of the series. Maddie, any surprises to this point with Golden State winning at home, Milwaukee winning at home? Anything surprise you at this point with the two series?
Honestly, no. I think Golden State is kind of a foregone conclusion. As fantastic as Portland's story has been up to this point, they've reached the end. I mean, if we come back and they have beaten Golden State, like, go ahead and I will take that one. But it doesn't seem like they're going to go any further past this. And I mean, in the East, two really good teams. Home team gets the advantage. Toronto looked a little tired towards the end there, yeah, but put up a good fight. I think that's going to be a really good series.
Yeah. Either of these series turn from the favorite? Do you see it happening, Eric? Would something have to happen? I mean, obviously we know Golden State playing without Kevin Durant, but seemingly still has enough firepower. Obviously, that's a roster that practically won before Durant showed up. So is there something that would have to happen in either of those series to make you deviate from thinking the two favorites, two top seeds win?
Kevin Durant's going to have to not show up. If he shows up, this isn't even a contest. And Damian Lillard and CJ McCollum are going to have to play the way they played against the Thunder. You kind of got some good, some bad, kind of an up and down from them in Denver, but you got enough for them to get through that series. They're both going to have to be on at the same time. There's no way they're going to be able to beat the Golden State Warriors, and not just offensively, but defensively. I thought defensively was actually more of their problem in the first game. They looked tired, both of them, and they were just letting Steph Curry get clean looks off of one screen. It wasn't like he had to fight multiple times to get off of screens to get clean looks at three-pointers. He was just getting one screen or a drag coming up in transition, and it was an easy three-point look for him. They can't allow that to happen. They need to be better defensively, and they need to be back to where they were hitting at the rate that they were against Oklahoma City. So it's going to be really tough for them to swing that series. And as for Toronto, I don't know if there's any way that Toronto can get the advantage unless Milwaukee does something that they're not prone to doing well. For instance, if they just go cold from three-point range.
Yeah.
If Milwaukee starts missing a bunch of threes, then Toronto's going to have a chance in the series. But Milwaukee's a better offense. They're one of the best defenses in the league, regardless of whether or not they're hitting shots. And basically, they're just going to have to go cold from three. You know, Brooke Lopez blew up in game one. If they go cold from three, then Toronto's got a shot in the series.
I thought Toronto missed a great opportunity in game one against Milwaukee. Maddie, you know, obviously Milwaukee had a break. They looked a little rusty, and I know there was some thought, you know, is Toronto sort of, you know, spent from that emotion of a game seven, a game-winning shot, all of that. But then they build the lead. I thought, you know, maybe they can steal one. They seem to really miss that opportunity in game one. I don't know if they can recover from that in this series.
No, they really did. And I think Milwaukee came in there being like, we can't lose a game one again. So they had that fire behind them. And when you're at home, that's just going to give you that little extra edge. And Toronto put up a good fight, but then you could see, I mean, you had guys playing. A lot of their starters played 40 minutes at a time, and so when Kawhi Leonard is clearly looking fatigued at the end of the game, like, there's only so much you can do.
You know, watching the Bucks last night in that game one, and I think we may have even talked about this before, either here or on the pod, or maybe I heard you guys talk about it. The way the Bucks play sort of makes me miss the young Thunder days. They're athletic. They're, you know, they just really, just some unbelievable individual talents, but they play really well as a team. I was sort of missing the young Thunder last night watching the Bucks. Giannis, unbelievable too. I mean, just a fantastic team. I don't know if they can beat the Warriors in the finals, but Eric, that's a good team.
No, and the key for Milwaukee is they defend as well as any team in the league. They can switch seamlessly. They can guard without switching, which is what they're really good at and what they pride themselves on. Not dying on screens, guys staying with the initial assignment and not having to switch. Giannis can guard anybody on the floor. Eric Bledsoe is an All-NBA guy in terms of his defense. They just don't give up anything on the defensive end. They've got the length and the athleticism that those young Thunder teams reminded us of, and they have the mentality to go with it. So that's been key for them more than anything, because even when their shot isn't going down, they can still win games with their defense, but they have more shooting than the Thunder, and they just have a generational talent in Giannis, yeah, who is 6'11", and can dribble twice and get to the rim from the three-point line. That's just not something or a weapon that a lot of teams can have.
I said this to somebody earlier today. If people feel like they haven't seen enough of the Bucks this year, just sit down and soak in Giannis, because he is worth just focusing on during those broadcasts. Before we get out of here, predictions for these series? Where it sounds like
chalk.
So, well, how many games? How many games for Golden State? They sweep, or does it take more than that?
I'll give them, assuming that KD is out for another couple, I'll say in five.
Okay. All right. Eric?
Five sounds right for that. I think it'll be a gentleman's sweep, so to say. I think the Blazers can get a game at the Moda Center, maybe game three, once they get a little bit more rest and then they get boosted by the crowd. I think they can get that. They can stretch it to five.
Does Milwaukee need longer than five? Or you?
I'd say six.
You say six?
Oh. Maddie's stealing all my. six sounds right. I think it can be a situation where, you know, Toronto could win. Two at home.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Milwaukee win, split on the road, and then win one at home.
Yeah.
The one thing that I have been surprised about going back to the West is that Enes Kanter's shoulder is still on him. Because if anyone, I've had a very mildly separated shoulder, and that thing hurts. And he is out here dunking and doing all kinds of crazy things. That would be my one surprise. But yeah, no, I think five and six. So
it's the Ramadan special. He's so weak that he can't even feel the pain anymore.
Use anything to your advantage, right? Exactly.
Enes Kanter's a tough guy, man. He's working through it, and he's had a great playoffs, and he deserves the success that he's having right now.
Yeah, it's going to be – hey, he's gonna be fun. Speaking of fun to watch, if you're looking for somebody to watch, watch that guy. See what he's up to. Lots of playoff basketball still left. Sorry, no Thunder, but lots left to watch. So be sure to stay with the best coverage team anywhere at newsok.com and every day in the Oklahoman.